So he also talks about stimulus analyticity 1960 and refers to it as a strictly vegetarian imitation, as though there's something wrong. I mean, people might be confused by Quine's metaphors and say, oh, that's a good thing, it's ethically nice or something, but that's not what he meant, I think. It's supposed to be deficient in some way. So I'll say something about...
Without the meat.
Without the meat, I mean, you've got to have the meat. That's the argument, essentially.
Is to come up with an improvement over a pre-existing notion.
Right.
But there's always going to be some purpose in mind. You alluded to that with the last slide. What would be the various purposes that you would see from these improved analytic synthetic distinctions?
Purpose would be methodological. Carnap thinks that a good concept of analyticity
got some work to do.
Yeah.
Yeah. What's the work? Right. That's maybe that's too broad, or right.
Carnap thinks that an analytic synthetic distinction is, for methodological reasons, practically indispensable. He thinks that to make sense of, say, the distinctions between logical geometries and their interpretations, you need to have a proposal such as the analytic synthetic distinction to sort of, I would say, bifurcate the non-factual from factual, but also in a way integrate them in an empiricist framework and make sense of these distinct kinds of statements that we have in science. I think that is a sort of methodological utility that you can have from the
distinction. So it comes down to this pragmatic question, because Quine presumably would say, I mean, people here are better Quine scholars than I am, but we have no need for that distinction.
Yes.
Right. And so then it just comes down to, well, you know, what's the need for?
I agree. I think Quine, in his two dogmas in the last section, precisely says that. He presents a kind of dispensability argument against Carnap's perceived indispensable distinction. He says, look, I have a new epistemology. It seems pretty rich. It seems, it's holistic, and it does away with all of these obscure primitives, semantic primitives that you've taken in your philosophical program. You can't seem to explain those concepts. I have an epistemology that does away with these concepts.
It doesn't need them.
Doesn't require them, you're right. And in a way, it dispenses away with the with the distinction. Yes, Gary?
Well, yeah, following up on this, Quine, as Rick pointed out in his talk, in the Carnap lectures at Harvard, fastened on, I think I'm quoting him, forestalling awkward questions about the a priori as a reason to call something that we're unwilling to revise analytic or secured by the rules. And I think that tracks, although in a very deflated way, Carnap's way of thinking about why you need the distinction. So you need to you need it to reconcile, as you pointed out earlier in the talk, logic and math with empiricism, according to Carnap. But this is where, I'm agreeing with Stuart here, it's kind of, once you have Quine's alternative empiricist model to reconcile those, it's a little harder for Carnap to say you can't reconcile empiricism with logic and math unless you do this, right?
Right.
What's he going to say? I mean, that doesn't seem like a good argument anymore.
So the very fact that you can come up with an explication doesn't cut much ice if the thing you're explicating doesn't have any work to do.
So right. Just one comment and then Rick. I was just saying, yeah, so in his, by 1990s, two dogmas in retrospect, he says just that, but he talks about his revisability thesis or holism and says, look, I can do a better job than you, Carnap, but of course Carnap is dead. But Rick, go ahead.
It seems to me that we've got a dispensability argument only if the terms of that dispensability argument are clearer than the terms it's replacing. insofar as we think that there's a problem of figuring out the boundaries of analyticity for some reason,
right.
We've had at least as much of a problem, and I suggest even greater problem, combined, I think, most of this, with figuring out the boundaries and the sense of simplicity, conservatism, and so on. Simplicity is a notoriously difficult problem. Quine went after it a couple of times, giving at least four different explications each time, claiming that they were equivalent when they're not. And in one place, he basically, basically abandons it, saying, well, you know, it's not really relevant to the choosing between theories, only to the thinking up of theories. It has only heuristic value. Well, then it cannot play the role that it plays in Two Dogmas. So I think Two Dogmas is a brilliant sketch, but it's a dispensability argument only if the sketch can be filled in.
I see.
And in 50 years it wasn't.
Right. I think people like Gila Sher, I think that's how you pronounce her name?
Gila.
She's a wonderful person. I met her at Calgary and just a pleasure to talk with. I mean, she's sort of taken Quine and made some changes, made him more radical, provided a new holistic account, which also does away with the analytic synthetic distinction. It's a radical program, it's kind of a coherent foundationalism that she's starting from scratch, and she wrote a whole book. So I think some work has been done, and quite a bit of work has been done in sort of rethinking about the sketch and also expanding on it. So I think a case could be made against the distinction in that way.
Well, I'm in favor of pursuing both research programs.
I don't think you've
got knockdown arguments on either side.
Right.
But I certainly, I think Quine's sketch is enormously attractive, and certainly deserves a great deal of work. And Quine, at least, did not, in fact, put much meat on those bones. But I have a different sort of question, but I'll wait until we present this one.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I have just a request for clarification, actually. So you made a claim early on that Quine managed to meet the empirical challenge that he laid down for Carnap, or didn't. He went some distance for doing that. I just didn't see how that was so.
Yeah.
So maybe I can sort of explain why I didn't see it. It looks like, as you rightly noted, none of the explications analyticity that Quine comes up with are up to doing the methodological work that Carnap wanted it to do. So how does that count as meeting the challenge?
I think in one way he doesn't meet the challenge, because the challenge is no longer about intelligibility, but having both things, Quinean intelligibility or behavioralistic respectability, but also the epistemic work needs to be there as well.
Okay.
And clearly Quine is very explicit in saying, okay, fine, you may have these approximations, these vegetarian imitations of analyticity, but you don't have analyticity. So my argument in this mitigated sense surely is there, as good as it is, and he never... It doesn't seem to me he ever backed down from this argument. As I said, even in 1990s, he again talks about sort of epistemic costs that may result from having intelligible concepts of analyticity. So again, he reiterates this by the other argument, revisability, sort of holistic argument, that you have in another program, and it doesn't have this problem to begin with. Just accept this. But my contention is that the Quine and Carnap have different conceptions of explication to begin with. Greg Livers has done a lot of work on just this in various articles, actually. And I think I'm looking at it from... I can see why Quine will demand what he does, because of his conception of explication, which does require an analog at the everyday language. From Carnap's point of view, from his conception of explication, you can have a construction of the concept of analyticity at the meta language without having it necessarily have an analog at the everyday language to begin with. But he does accept the challenge and saying, okay, you know what, I'm kind of happy with my program, but I think I can actually satisfy your further behavioristic requirement as well in the following way of somehow socializing the concept. Now, I agree that we don't have a socialized concept at an everyday language, or we haven't found one at least, that's supposed to do the methodological work. But I don't think that is required. That shouldn't count as evidence to dismiss the philosophical program of Carnap altogether. I think the fact that you can have approximations is a work in progress, and especially and Quine can still be skeptical and still can be committed for his behavioristic reasons to his own program. But I think he can't also then say that Carnap, you should let go of your sense of explication for pragmatic considerations, let go of your philosophical program. Just because from Carnap, the fact that you can have these approximations should count as evidence or give you hope that it's a sort of a doable thing even at the everyday language. Let me be free and go on with my formal explications. Is that sort of...
Yeah, that's very helpful.
Okay, great. Awesome. Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I think you're right about that, but I think Quine underestimates his 1973 language learning conception of analyticity.
Okay.
So the problem with this is that it's supposed to be too restrictive. It doesn't get us.
Yeah.
But it seems like it should be very natural if you're going to give this language learning criterion to say, well, the analytic truths are the ones that everybody learns in learning language, and the deductive closure of those, because after all, one of the things we're going to learn when we're learning language is the logic.
Yeah.
So the logic is going to be part of the analytic truths. So if we've got these sort of primitive analytic truths that are admittedly restrictive, but then we're allowed the deductive closure of all of them, then it's not going to be so clear that this is an overly restrictive notion anymore.
I see. Right.
So I think Quine's challenges can be met from Quine's own perspective.
That's very interesting. Rick, go ahead.
I think that's right. But Quine admits that elementary logic does count as analytic by that criterion. But he says that mathematics won't. Why? Because mathematics is reducible to set theory, and there's still a level of disagreement about set theory. That argument does not, in fact, show that mathematics can't be done. Got it. You learn the word two, you learn it's bigger than one, and a lot of elementary mathematics would still count. But notice that if the distinction is just how widely it's accepted, we've got an explication. The only question then is whether it's analytic in English. And Carnap doesn't care about whether it's analytic in English. He's in the business of making proposals. And so he can propose that we adopt this set theory. We can propose that we adopt this logic, and so on. And consequently, logic and mathematics would be, since we now have an intelligible behavioral notion of adopting a language, according to Roots of Reference, then the royal road is open to him to make such proposals as he wants. Absent that behavioral criterion, however, he's not even making proposals. Like Quine can go back and say, look, you're not even making a proposal if I can't tell whether it's been adopted or not. So once Quine hands him that, he's handing him a lie. And for that matter, in 1992, in Pursuit, Quine himself adopts a two-tier system of epistemology, where the logic forms a level that does not yet disconfirm. And then the changes are all made elsewhere. Not for the reasons that were given back in Two Dogmas and Methods of Logic, but simply because the way he sets it up, and he repeats this and says, yes, I'm giving logic a different role. But Quine doesn't have principle boundary between what's logic and what's not. And so, in a sense, it's open to Carnap to say, You've handed me everything I need.
So that's all of mathematics can now fit in.
Yes.
Or at least a lot of it.
Right.
had a comment?
Yeah, I wanted to disagree with Rick, if I may. Quine pretty consistently, especially in places like Philosophy of Logic, but also elsewhere, kind of Logical Truth and so on, makes a big deal about what I'm going to call the epistemic import of the completeness theorem for first order of logic. So why is logic sort of behavioristically, all going to count as analytic by the behavioristic criterion? Well, because it's obvious, or as he says, potentially obvious. And what guarantees a potential obviousness? Well, completeness. That's what he says in Philosophy of Logic, for example. But that marks a pretty sharp boundary between logic and mathematics, then, because we don't have a completeness theorem for all of mathematics.
In that same paper, in Practical Logical Truth, he says logic is obvious, set theory is conventional. But if the dissident logicians become more influential, logic would cease to be obvious and become conventional. And if you settled on one set theory would cease to be conventional and become obvious. So it's simply a matter of counting noses, which is distressing.
Would it be okay if I shift the topic a little?
Sure.
Yes. I mean, we've been around this place.
That's right. Who's the chair of the session?
Who is the chair of the session? Is it okay?
We've got a tiny bit more time.
Okay, I wanted to challenge something else that you said and then Rick says about Quine. That his fundamental challenge is amounts of demand for empirical criteria for making sense of the analytic synthetic. I don't want to deny that it's part of the challenge, but I guess here's a reason to worry about that way of putting it. So Quine thinks it's perfectly coherent and clear to just say things like there are quarks as part of physics, right? And he doesn't say, I have no idea what you're talking about, there are quarks, until you tell me its relationship to behavioral evidence. And in fact, he said, if you asked him, so what is the relation? He says, it's obscure, and no one really can retrace it. All I can do is give you a kind of logistic story about the multifarious ways in which sentences are interconnected, which is not an answer to how it's related at all. It's not even close. So he's fine with there are quarks. That's perfectly clear to him.
Okay.
And he has no story whatever to tell about how that's related to observation of any interest at all. So it seems, I don't think he does. And he says in the beginning of Word and Object, that chemical theory is related to observation by multifarious ways that are basically impossible to recover, and you can only conjecture about them and speculate. And that's his official view, that you can kind of give a just-so story about that overcomes some of that anxiety, and it's all psychological, and you get over it by saying, well, whatever it is, it's dispositions that relate sentences to sentences and ultimately to observation. But it's just a big ball of wax or a ball of jello or something, and that's not an answer. And so I don't think that can be his fundamental criticism against the analytic synthetic. It's got to be something else, because he doesn't satisfy it on his own terms for the things that he finds clear.
Yes. I didn't know about the quarks, actually.
Check out Word and Object Chapter 1, where he makes this claim, and he makes it repeatedly whenever he tells his genetic story. There is really no ultimate answer to how sentences happen. I mean, this is what indeterminacy is about. When you get higher up, there is simply no notion of meaning that can be defined for the individual sentences in a behaviorist way. This can't be done. And so, that's my problem with this reading, that ultimately it's about coming up with standards in terms of behavior for analytic synthetic. I don't think that's it.
Okay.
I think that brings us to the end of our session. Thank you.
Thank you.
Sorry, that was more monologue then. I apologize. I'm sure Rick has a comeback.
He does, but he's not going to give it. You're not going to wheel it out.
Late.
Yeah, right.
Nice job.
Yes.
What's your first name?
Yusuf.
Yusuf. Okay. Nice job.
Thanks for the helpful comments. I really appreciate it.
I think you underplay what is maybe the most important part of your talk,
okay.
Is that Quine is the applicant to Carnap's own method against Carnap's, the rejection of metaphysics.
Okay.
And that maybe that could be more of a scientific underlying theme of the way you do it.
All right, perfect. No, I'll work on it.
I have some papers where I say something along those lines too, but you know, you've got a slightly different version of the story, so that's good.